Desert Island Discs, 70 Years of Castaways, with Foreword by Kirsty Young, compiled and edited by Sean Magee, read by Alex Jennings and Juliet Stevenson.
Foreword by Kirsty Young. Let me ask you a question. It's a hard habit to break. What do the late Prince Chula Chakrabonsi of Thailand and Ian Hislop have in common? Two men born more than half a century and half a world apart, it's tricky to imagine what could possibly unite them. Unlike one of our best-known satirists, His Royal Highness didn't, as far as we're aware, harbour a deep-seated love of the breakfast treat Frosties. Yet, when it came to choosing the 8 discs they couldn't be without on a desert island, the Prince and the Private Eye editor were very much in tune. Though their programmes were broadcast 34 years apart, nestling among each man's little bundle of choices was a disc by the debonair comedy actor Jack Buchanan. Who would have thought it? For 70 years now, Desert Island Discs has managed that rare feat, to be both enduring and relevant. By casting away the biggest names of the day in science, business, politics, showbiz and the arts, it presents a cross-sectional snapshot of the times in which we live. As the decades have passed, the programme has kept pace, never frozen in time, yet always, somehow, comfortingly, the same. And here we must surely tip our hat to Roy Plumley. Like most truly great ideas, the welly boot, the sandwich, the spell check, the premise of Desert Island Discs is stunning in its simplicity. A person of significant accomplishment enters into a bargain with the Beeb. They chat about their life, and we play the 8 discs they've chosen. What could be more straightforward? The humble genius of the format is that it cradles and shapes itself around each highly individual guest, like a well-tethered hammock slung between a pair of obliging palm trees. Back in 1942, before publicity junkets and PRs, YouTube and tweeting, one person talking to another person, whilst other folk tuned in on the wireless, must surely have seemed like a jolly bright idea. But now, in 2012, for 45 minutes, are you mad? Well, no, you're not. Indeed, it could reasonably be argued that among the constant flow of instant verbiage that swirls non-stop around us these days, the opportunity to take a decent amount of time to properly appreciate and examine the life of someone significant is more welcome than ever. But of course, the chat is only part of it. 29 minutes if you're counting, and I very much hope you are. What about the other essential component, the discs? Where do castaways begin when it comes to choosing the pieces that'll illustrate and illuminate who they are and how their life has been? Naturally, no two castaways are the same, and every recording takes on a character all its own. But if there is one common utterance from every single guest who sits in the studio, and there is, it goes like this. It was almost impossible to choose just 8. The self-editing process for a guest is swinging. If they're playing the game properly, it can't all be just Beethoven or Dylan. It's about pinpointing pieces that cast light on their life's most significant moments. Adversities conquered, children born, lovers lost, laughter shared. As a result, their little list of discs is often very surprising indeed. When the former head of MI5, the redoubtable Eliza Manningham Buller, told me she'd decided on a track from the Detroit garage rockers, The White Stripes, it was all I could do not to punch the air and shout, "Wowza!" It's a formula that works then, but the programme is hopefully never formulaic. In my mind, it works best as a sort of triangulated conversation. Castaway, host and listener, sitting around the table, engaged in a no-holds-barred dialogue about how the guest of honour got to where they are and what it's like to live the life they've lived. I say no-holds-barred because that's the deal. There is no deal. We never agree questions beforehand, no matter how platinum-plated the castaway. And keeping the listener engaged often means being very nosy and very persistent. Yet, Desert Island Discs is unashamedly a celebration of achievement. The people who come on are there because they matter. From Field Marshal Montgomery to Dame Tanny Gray Thompson, all of them have reached the heights in their chosen field. They are different from the rest of us. More talented, more ambitious, more energetic, and often more insecure. And since we happen to be on the subject of anxiety, these days I often wonder if the only reason I'm ever asked anywhere is because people want to know the lowdown and dirty on desert island discs. I am constantly filleted for information about castaways. How do we choose them? Who's been the most interesting? Who's had the worst music? Who was the rudest? Who's been your favourite? Well, for fear of never being invited anywhere ever again, I hereby refuse to definitively answer any of those questions right now. But I will pull back the curtain a few inches and offer you a behind-the-scenes glimpse of what goes on off-mic, as we say in the business. It's well known that Roy Plumley used to take castaways to his club prior to recordings, furnishing them with what might reasonably be called a good lunch. Whether it was a social nicety or a bid to loosen their tongues, it's one of the few programme traditions that's gone by the board. These days, BBC budget constraints mean we run to a cup of tea or some fizzy water. There's a lot to be said for tradition. So, the first chance I get to meet our castaways face to face is when they arrive for the recording. Minutes are precious then, and none of them are wasted. Some turn up at the doors of Broadcasting House with an entourage. The elderly American comedian Jackie Mason was trailing three people, and one of them was trailing the longest mink coat I've ever clapped eyes on. It was not a cold day. Some arrive alone. Annie Lennox, 10 Grammys, 4 Ivanovello Awards, 8 Brits, a Golden Globe and an OBE, pitched up entirely by herself, save for a packet of shop-bought sandwiches. Then there was 73-year-old Yoko Ono in a plunging top, tiny fedora, and very big, very black sunglasses. Barry Manilow was in shades too. However, unlike Yoko, he did me the favour of taking them off for the recording. For a short time, we settled down in the control room, the booth with all the knobs and buttons next door to the studio. And then, over tea and the occasional biscuit, we listened to the castaways' choices, double-checking that for each we have exactly the right track, and firming up which precise 2 minutes the castaway would like to be played. Incidentally, Sir Tom Jones didn't get mere biscuits with his tea. He was accorded the privilege of homemade Welsh cakes, not from my home, but from the oven of the Welsh-born mother of the programme's producer, Mrs. Buckle, I salute you. The pride of the valleys stuffed 3 in his pockets as he left. So, with discs double-checked and entourages ensconced, it's off into the studio, but not, crucially, to the island. And that's another one of the very few differences between way back then and now. Roy Plumley would welcome listeners with the words, "On our desert island this evening." These days, much later in the programme, I say to my guest, "I'm about to cast you away." Somehow that makes more sense to me. The cruelty of abandoning someone to a life of solitude and sunburn is surely bad enough. To suggest that I might actually be dumping them there myself and then swanning off seems indefensible. And so we come to the interview, the conversation. What's its point? What's the aim? For me, it's to strike up an intimacy with the guest that allows them to trust me and in turn properly reveal themselves. I want the listener to come as close as they can to meeting them without actually meeting them. The best piece of professional advice I was ever given, aged 22 and working at BBC Radio Scotland, was listen. Listen to what people say. In the 22 years since, what I've also learned is do your homework. Then, be ready to ditch every smarty-pants question you have on your list in pursuit of original, fresh, immediate dialogue. It's always good to be prepared, but above all else, be prepared to listen to the answers and take it from there. My predecessor Sue Lawley once described Desert Island Discs as the best job in radio. I would find it hard to disagree.
My castaway this week is... In June 2012, Aung San Suu Kyi, the inspirational opposition leader in Burma, finally made it to Oslo to collect the Nobel Peace Prize awarded to her more than 2 decades earlier. In her acceptance speech, she recalled that when she'd been living in Oxford many years ago, she had listened to Desert Island Discs with her young son, Alexander, and he had asked her whether she might ever be invited to appear on the programme. He was aware that, in general, only celebrities took part, and wondered for what reason she might be invited. I considered this for a moment, and then answered, "Perhaps because I'd have won the Nobel Prize for Literature," and we both laughed. The prospect seemed pleasant, but hardly probable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.